Turn your Bibles to Ezekiel chapter 2. Ezekiel chapter 2. We're actually going to look at chapters 6, 7, and 8 for this evening, but I want to talk about.
There's something wrong with the connection there.
Okay.
You might just have to talk louder than mine.
Okay. So this is the PA on?
Yeah, it's making up. Is that on?
Ezekiel chapter 3, but I want to look at chapter 2 for just a second. Y'all probably noticed after I reprimanded Jimmy Dale about the parking lot, he got serious and got it going. We'll see if the same thing works on the PA system. How many of you can remember watching the bombing of Baghdad during the first Desert Storm? How many of you saw that night after night? I think it was 38 consecutive nights. And the first time in history, the people had been made aware the bomb is going to start pretty much about this day. And there were all types of newscasters there. And you watched what looked like a massive fireworks show night after night after night. And the people in that city of about 8 million people were pummeled every single night for 38 consecutive days. What I will tell you is what we're looking at tonight. God takes Ezekiel, much like he did the Apostle Paul, much like he did John the Revelator, as a black preacher friend of mine called him, and he pulled him up. One time it says he took him by the hair and he carried him around and he showed him. Now, Ezekiel was in Babylon. Ezekiel was told to stand up, turn toward Jerusalem, and you're going to see what happens to Jerusalem. And he did. Now, this was right before it was going to happen. I want you to think about where we have been studying now, the books of Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel. And we talked about this before. And I gave you an example of this. This being the time period of Hezekiah. This being the time period of Josiah. So back here we have Isaiah, 100 years before, talking about what's going to happen when the city is destroyed. and the 70 years afterward. Then you have Jeremiah that comes along here, and then you have Ezekiel. Ezekiel is in Babylon, but he grew up. He was 25 years old when he was taken to Babylon. He was already married, and so he had lived in this city. Now let me tell you the great problem that you see in the time of Ezekiel. Most of the people... Got your attention? Okay, Charles has it fixed now. Shelby goes out of town and things just fall apart. So most of the people who were in Babylon were the same wicked, idolatrous people that were pulled out of Jerusalem, and they weren't any different than they were. A number of them were children who really and truly believed that it was going to be over in time, and they were going to be carried back to Jerusalem, and they were going to see the beautiful city and all the buildings and the temple. And what Jeremiah told them, and also Ezekiel says, is it's not going to happen. Get that out of your mind. The latter part of the book of Jeremiah says, build houses, plant fields. You're going to be in Babylon a while, and if you don't understand that, you're not going to be happy. What Ezekiel is saying is, God says, I want you to see this. Just like when maybe you saw the city of Baghdad being destroyed, Ezekiel's going to see it, and he's going to come to the people and say, this is what's happening. You can't see it, but I saw it. And they would say, how did you see it? You were here with us. The Lord showed it to me. That's what you're going to see in chapters 2, 3, 6, and 7. In chapter 7, what I want you to think about is this. If God decides to destroy a nation, what does it look like one layer at a time? And what I want you to think about is, how are these interrelated? And I'm talking about when the economy falls apart. Four things in particular: social, military, economic, and political. And I want to spend just a second before coming into this. How many of you were actually alive and can remember some part of the Depression, the Great Depression? Well, see, that's the question. Nobody wants to tell you that they're that old. Did this entire country go under during the Great Depression? No. In fact, 10 to 20% of this nation became fabulously wealthy during that period of time. By 1938, even though we didn't get into World War II until 41, December 7th, 1941, there were already factories being equipped, and there were different type of machinery built for Europe in 1938-39. That's really what got people out. So what happens when an entire nation is destroyed? Not 50%, not 80% like we had here, and took literally going into World War II to get over. Everything falls apart. That's what I want to talk about this evening. For just a moment, in chapter 2 and verse 2. Verse 1, chapter 2 and verse 1. He, God, said to me, Son of man, stand on your feet that I may speak to you. And he spoke to me. As he spoke to me, the Spirit entered me and set me on my feet. And I heard him speaking to me. What do you think capital S means? The Holy Spirit. I hear people make comments from time to time indicating that the Holy Spirit was a New Testament phenomenon. Is that true? Anybody know the first time this capital S is used in the Bible? Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. In the beginning, what does he say? It was the Word. And the Spirit of the Lord was moving over the waters. That's all the way back to the second verse in the Bible. So in chapter 3 and verse 12, now what you see is the Holy Spirit is speaking to him in chapter 3. In verse 12, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit lifted me up, and I heard a great rumbling sound behind me. Blessed be the glory of the God in his place. So the Spirit lifted me up and took me away. I want to focus on that for just a moment, because what I'm trying to do in this is show you how much of this is consistent with God. It has been consistent for thousands of years.
I've got a question. In Genesis chapter 1, he said he spoke of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. You know, John tells us that the Father is Spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. How do we make the distinction? I don't believe there's a distinction there. I believe that the Holy Spirit and the Father and Christ, who is part of the Godhead, they are one. I believe that the Bible tells that they are one.
I'd like to discuss that with you, because I think you're dead wrong in there. Now, I want to show you something. I want to read this. So everybody turn to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 2. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 2. Are the Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, and God three completely separate entities of the Godhead?
Yeah. Okay. Well, I remember that.
All right, verse 2, Genesis 1 and 2. The earth was formless and void, and darkness was over the surface of the deep. And what does it say? The Spirit of God was moving on the surface of the water. Okay? Was the Holy Spirit present during the creation of the world?
Yes. All of the world. Jesus said that in the beginning I was there, and all things were made by me. Well, what do you mean? Were they made by the Spirit? Were they made by Christ? Were they made by God? See, I understand that in the Old Testament there was no Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. These identities took life in the New Testament. And why is the word Father used to describe Father the God? Because He is the originator of all things. Why is Christ described as the Son of God? Because He is our example. And why is the Spirit called the Holy Spirit? Because He is the mind of God. And that's why they took these identifications.
I'd like to give you about a dozen verses that are on my mind right now and have you explain to me what they mean.
Where is the reference that we studied not too long ago? It's in the books of history. Mm-hmm. Where God kept Jesus in the hidden in His hand. That reference there, where they didn't mention Him being the Messiah or the Christ, but He talked about having Him hidden in His hand for a later time.
Yeah, Isaiah, I think it's chapter 7.
Also in Isaiah, He said, "I, God alone."
What He said in His
hand. He's talking about the Jehovah God, God the Father, where He said, "I alone," in the book of Isaiah a couple of times, that He did things but separate. I would just say to you that I know people that see it the way you do. I could write a number of passages up here. I'd like for you to explain how those are different. Yes, ma'am.
Usually the word of, like it says, the Spirit of God, mm-hmm. of is possessive. Mm-hmm. He owns it. So
that's
it's
right.
Part of Him.
That's
so
right.
I can kind of see where it's going.
However, the word God can be singular or plural. Can mean God the Father, can be God the Son, or God the Holy Spirit. All of them are called God. All right, I don't want to get too far off that. But what I want to talk about is this. Something that was very common for God is to take people that would be prophets and basically have the Holy Spirit grab them and carry them and show them things. I want to show you in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 10 that's exactly what happened to the Apostle John. I want to show you in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 through 5, where the Apostle Paul was carried away into the third heaven. And he says in this text that he didn't know, was he actually carried, or whether he was in the physical body, or whether he was in the spirit. He did not know. And the point I want to make there, just before moving into the sixth chapter, is what you see in the book of Ezekiel is something that you see over and over and over, and that is the Holy Spirit taking someone. They believed it was physical, that He physically carried him, picked him up, and carried him away. I want to show you in 2 Corinthians 10 for just a moment. This is very similar to the revelation. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, the Apostle Paul talks about an event that happened to him. And I want you to look at it with me and how he sees that. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. 2 Corinthians 12, and then we'll have our opening prayer. How many of you know about Paul's thorn in the flesh? Have ever heard about it, ever read about it? So it occurs in this chapter. Before Paul starts talking about his thorn in the flesh, he tells you something, and I want to show you how the two are tied together. In chapter 12 and verse 1, boasting is necessary. That is, telling you something that happened to you, me, to make a point is necessary. Though it's not profitable, and I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether in the body, I do not know, or out of the body, I do not know, God knows, such a man was caught up to the third heaven. And I know how such a man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, God knows, was caught up into paradise. And I heard inexpressible words which a man is not permitted to speak. On behalf of such a man, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not, except in regard to my weaknesses. Now, what do you get from what the Apostle Paul said? Number one, do you feel like he's talking about himself?
Yes.
Yes. It's been very difficult for him to know any other person that intimately. And so God showed him and told him all kinds of things that he couldn't grasp. He also couldn't tell anybody else. Now, in the seventh verse, and because of the surpassing greatness of the revelation given to me. Now, what do you think he's talking about in that text? That was part of what just happened. He had seen things, this massive amount of revelation. Because of that, he was given a thorn in the flesh. Now, what I want to go back to now, to the book of Ezekiel, and I want to have you look at this with me. I want to look in chapter 6 beginning. And the point I want you to grasp is multiple times as you take a look at the prophets, Old Testament and New Testament prophets, the Apostle John says, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. And the Spirit showed me certain things. And he showed him a picture of Jesus Christ holding candles. And then he says, these are the angels of the churches that he goes into in chapter 2 and 3. In all three of these cases, what you have is the Holy Spirit grabbing someone, sometimes physically, sometimes they didn't know. Ezekiel says several times, I was lifted up and carried. Now, I don't know if he made a trip to Jerusalem. The Lord said to him, turn and look. What you are going to see in the 6th and 7th chapter is what he saw. In chapter 3 and 6 both, it says that the Spirit grabbed him by the hair. You'll see that as we read it in just a moment. So I want to pick this up in chapter 6 in just a moment. Byron, would you lead us in prayer, please?
Father in heaven, I'm thankful for the opportunity you've given us to meet here tonight and study your word. Dear Lord, we're thankful for everything that you give us, for all the blessings that we have, for our health, our wealth, the roofs over our heads. Dear Lord, help us to always strive to live by your word and to be a good example to others. Dear Lord, help us to always learn and strive to do the best that we can. Forgive us of our sins. This we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Chapter 6 and verse 1. And the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, set your face toward the mountains of Israel and prophesy against them. And say, mountains of Israel, listen to the word of the Lord God. Thus saith the Lord God to the mountains, to the hills, to the ravines, to the valleys. And I want to stop for a minute. Did he say this to the people?
No.
What I've said to you a number of times is God always controlled the land. Always controlled the land. When a nation became ungodly, God would take them off the land. You see it throughout all of history, all the way from the children of Israel to here. So God is now prophesying to the land. I want you to look at that for just a moment, because he's going to talk about why that's important. Taking a look now in verse 3. Verse 4. So your altars will become desolate. The latter part of verse 3. Behold, I myself am going to bring a sword on you, and I will destroy your high places. What are the high places? That's where the idols were. The idols were in the mountains. They were around, in and around the mountains. And they had beautiful trees. He's going to talk about it in a moment. So the altars, your altars will become desolate. And your and your incense altars will be smashed. And I will make you your slain fall in front of the idols. Why do you think God's doing that? He's going to tell you in just a minute. But why do you think? So here are high places. And he says, I'm going to destroy people with a sword right in front of the idols that they worship. Why?
So they'll know those false gods can't save them.
And that's exactly what he says. I want you to know, there's not going to be any doubt. This wasn't bad luck. This wasn't foolishness. This was something that I did. Yes, sir.
Didn't Jeroboam have those created?
Absolutely. All the way back to 1 Kings chapter 11. Where did the idol start? Jeroboam. Now, here's the problem. Jeroboam was the first king of what? The northern kingdom.
Israel.
All right, so you think about this. Here's the northern kingdom up here. This is where the 10 tribes were, 10 and a half. So this is Judah down here. The reason why this nation has been gone for 120 years is they never had a godly king. They started with idolatry in this land, and it's what took them down. This nation at least has eight godly, eight ungodly kings. But absolutely, this started with Jeroboam. What he wanted was to stay in power and make the people love him. And the way he was going to do it was, I'm going to make an idol for you where you don't have to go back to Jerusalem. Now, what was he really trying to do? He did not want them to go back and intermingle with their brethren in Jerusalem. He was trying to keep them out of that. Now, look at this in verse 5. I shall lay the dead bodies of the sons of Israel in front of what? Now, somebody said a minute ago, we're talking about a possessive pronoun. T-H-E-I-R. Is that a possessive pronoun? I'm going to lay them in front of their idols. By this time, there were many, many idols. And different people worshiped different ones. Now look at this for just a moment. Verse 6, in all your dwelling places, cities will become a waste, and the high places will be desolate, that your altars may become a waste and desolate, and your idols be broken and brought into the inn, and your incense altars may be cut down, and your works may be blotted out, and the slain will fall among you, and you shall know what?
I am the Lord.
I don't want there to be any doubt. I don't want people to miss what just happened here. Have you ever known people that their life was a mess? And you start talking to them about, how did you mess your life up like this? How did you make this many bad decisions? And instantly, well, they. And what you don't hear is, I messed up. My fault. I'm why this happened. God is telling these people, you cannot miss this program. You're going to understand. Now, verse 8, however, I will leave a remnant for you. We'll have those who escape with the sword amongst the nations when you are scattered amongst the countries. Then those of you who escape will remember me among the nations to which they will be carried. That's going to be the remnant, the ones that remembered God. And when Cyrus gave them a chance to come back, they said, I'll take it. Cyrus even had their neighbors to help them financially get back there. Now look at this. This is the middle of verse 9. How I have been hurt by their adulterous hearts, which have turned away from me, and by their eyes, which played the harlot after their idols, and they will loathe themselves in their own sight for the evils which they have committed, for all their abominations. God says, when this happens, and this is a theme that you're going to see going through it, you're going to know that this is on you. You caused it. I'm going to make sure you cannot miss this. And they will understand that their abominations were what caused this to happen to them. A little further. Verse 10. They will know that I am the Lord. I have not said in vain that I will inflict this disaster on them. Thus says the Lord God, clap your hands, stomp your foot, say, alas, behold to the evil abominations of the house of Israel, which will fall by sword, famine, and plague. You're going to see this over and over and over and over. These are the three ways that God destroys a nation. Look at the next verse. He who is far off. Now here's somebody that has already been carried away out of Judah to Egypt or to Babylon, to other places. But they were wicked when they were here. Somebody look at that verse and tell me what happens to those who have been carried off.
They get the plague.
They die by the plague.
They die by the plague. Now, the one thing that the Lord says throughout this text is, you're not going to miss the object of the exercise here. You're not going to miss it. You're going to know that when it happens, whether you're in Jerusalem or whether you're in Babylon or whether you're in Egypt or Moab or Edom, you are not going to miss the fact that this happened because of how you live and choices that you made. Look what he said. He who is afar off, verse 12, will die by the plague. He who is near will fall by the sword. That's because because Nebuchadnezzar's armies by this time had laid a siege wall around this entire city for 14 months. He says, and he who remain and is besieged will die from what?
Famine.
We talked about this about 2 weeks ago or so in Jeremiah, where the children were eating their own children, eating the flesh of their parents. Can you imagine things getting that bad? These were the people that God loved, that were his children. Let me ask this question. Make sure that we're clear here. Did he do this because he hated them? Why did he do it?
He wanted to show them how evil they were.
Well, that made him mad. It says right there where you stop reading, thus will I spend my wrath on them.
And you're going to see that about four times in chapter 6 and 7. So I want you to understand, he made it clear. I'm doing this because I love you. I'm doing it because I want things to be better for your children and your grandchildren, and I want to raise up a different nation of people. And let me say this, and I made this comment, and Brother Owen made a comment about it. Of all the problems that the Sadducees and Pharisees had in the New Testament, were they idolaters? Huh? God fixed that problem. This nation, 600 years later in the time of Jesus Christ, still didn't worship idols again. God got their attention. A little bit further down, verse 13. Then you will know that I am the Lord. The latter part of verse 12 that Jason just talked about. Thus I shall spend my wrath on them. Then you will know that I am the Lord, and their slain will be among their idols, and around their altars, and on every high hill, and all the tops of the mountains, and under every green tree, and under every leafy oak, the places where they offered soothing aroma to what? I want you to picture this. Imagine a mountainous place, very similar, interestingly, to Denver, Colorado. So Denver is called the Mile High City. Anybody know why it's called the Mile High City?
It's 5,200 feet elevation.
5,200 feet elevation. But it's down in a bowl. And you have mountains all around it. And the mountains all around it are 6,500 up to 10,000 feet. Jerusalem is very similar to this. So there were high places all around, and there were all types of idols, temples here, and there were beautiful trees that were planted. And what God said is, you're going to die right there where you offered this soothing aroma. Let me tell you what he's going to say in a minute. But I'm going to just ask this question. All of you have been to plenty of funerals in your day. I couldn't count how many times I've been to this cemetery right back here, or in the one in West Columbia or Angleton. When we have a funeral service and we put someone in the casket and we bury them, what does that represent? What are we trying to accomplish or feel like we're trying to accomplish? You ever thought about that?
Basically returning them back to the dust to dust kind of thing, returning them back to the earth from which they came.
Okay. Uh-huh. All right. And all of those are good.
Closure.
Say it again.
Closure.
Closure. Okay. Is it designed to be a sign of respect for that person? How do you handle their body after they were gone? So what happens when God says, none of you will be buried? None of you. You're going to die, and the birds of prey are going to eat your body right where you worship the idol. What do you think that meant? It was the ultimate shame, the ultimate disrespect.
Look at Jezebel.
Say it again.
Look at Jezebel.
Jezebel, the dogs ate her. All right, chapter 7 now. Verse 14, that's a 6 and 14. So throughout all their habitations, I will stretch out my hand against them and make the land more desolate and waste in the wilderness towards Diblah. Thus they will know that I am the Lord their God. Chapter 7 now is the chapter that I really want to focus on. Moreover, or above and beyond that, the word of the Lord came to me saying, and you, son of man, thus saith the Lord God to the land of Israel, and end. The end is coming on the four corners of the land. The idea being, unlike Jeremiah, who was about 20 years older than Ezekiel, they were contemporaries. One of them was in Babylon, the other one in Jerusalem. But they're sitting right on the edge now. It is there. They are about to see it. So just a short time, or perhaps in real life, Ezekiel is seeing with his eyes what he's going to have to turn around and explain to these people. And he's going to say, let me tell you one of the things that made them the most despondent was, you're not going back to Jerusalem. One of these days, you'll come back to the land. But if you picture Jerusalem being this beautiful city, and right in the center of the city on the Temple Mount was what? The temple. It ain't there. All of it has been burned to the ground. Well, they didn't like that, you might guess. In chapter 7 and verse 2, or verse, the end is coming to the four corners. Now, the end is upon you, and I shall send my anger against you, and I shall judge your house to your ways. Your Bible say that, or something close to it? How is he going to pass judgment?
According to the conduct.
Based on how they lived and how they acted. I want to talk about what the New Testament says about that in just a moment. Verse 3, now the end is upon you, and I shall send my anger against you, and I shall judge you according to your ways. Does the New Testament teach us exactly the same thing today?
Yeah.
2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10. Look there with me for just a moment. 2 Corinthians 5 and 10. So the fact that we live under a different law than they lived under, they were under the Mosaical law, how God sees wickedness and faithfulness and how God judges us is exactly the same. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 10. For we all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ that we may be recompensed, we may be paid back or rewarded, good or bad, for the deeds in the body, according to what he has done, whether good or evil. Look in Romans, the 14th chapter. I would tell you that the Apostle Paul says this multiple times, but let's just look at a couple. Romans chapter 14. Romans chapter 14 and verse 10. Three other times this occurs in the New Testament. Romans 14 and 10. So Paul is writing this to different congregations of people in the New Testament period. Verse 10. Romans 14, 10. But you, why do you judge your brother? Or again, why do you regard your brother with contempt? For we shall all do what?
Stand before the judgment.
So what I'm going to tell you is, specifically, 2 Corinthians 5:10 is almost verbatim what you're seeing here. Now look at this. At verse 4, 7 and 4, for my eye will have no pity on you, nor spare you, but I shall bring your ways upon you, and your abomination will be among you. Then you will know that I am the Lord. It was going to happen in a way that they could not miss this. He had been telling them for 100 years, all the way back in the time of Isaiah, 100 years before, over and over and over. Now let me tell you, and I think that you would agree with me, how many of you, or could any of you study this in detail without asking the question, I wonder what God would say about America? Chapter 7 and verse 5. Thus saith the Lord God, a disaster, a unique disaster. I went back and took a look at the word unique is a very unique word in the Bible. In fact, it's incredibly unique. Now, King James says what? Somebody that reads King James, tell me. I was going to look at that and I didn't. This is chapter 7 and verse 5. A disaster. What does it say? An evil. An evil disaster, okay? All right. So I want to.
New King James says singular.
Singular. Okay.
One of a kind.
Mine says unheard of disaster.
So you're going to see the next. Say it again.
Mine says disaster after.
So we're going to read the next three or four verses, and I want you to get the context, what he's talking about. So there's going to be a disaster happen unlike they'd ever seen or heard of. It was going to be very peculiar or unique. Behold the Lord, verse 6, an end is coming. The end has come. It has awakened against you. Behold, it has come. Your doom shall have come, O inhabitants of the land. The time has come. The day is near. Tumult, rather than joy, shall be shouted in the mountains. So in their praise, when they were carrying on and they were singing and shouting, he said, that's not what's going to be happening in the mountains in this time. In verse 8, now I will shortly pour out my wrath on you. I want you to think about this. Here's a phrase that occurs in the Revelation multiple times. Full measure. The full measure of the wrath of God occurs, I think, three times. Imagine if you had a large bucket here and you filled it up with water and it was full. And that bucket represented the wrath of God. It's eventually going to be poured out, and then he's going to say to him, it's done. Let me tell you what I picture in my mind. You know this story. 2 Samuel chapter 24, when David was an old man and he was very depressed and upset, and he wanted to know how big an army that he had built. And he really wanted to know. And Joab and others were telling him, don't do it, don't do it. God doesn't want you to know. Oh, I got to know. When he numbered the troops, the prophet Gad came to him and said, God's given you three choices. You can spend the rest of your life running from people. He gave him three choices. He picked the 3 days of severe pestilence and famine. The scripture says that David could see the angel destroying Jerusalem, and he knew that he did it. Eventually, God said, enough! Stop! Pull back. 2 Samuel 24, if you want to read the story. his wrath had been poured out. Now, you see the same thing here. In verse 8, I will pour out my wrath on you and spend my anger against you, judge you according to your ways, and bring on you all your abominations. You remember how many times this is the great prayer that Isaiah prayed. This is Isaiah 64, where Isaiah said, please don't punish us beyond measure. You remember that? We read it, looked at it several times. God said, I will punish them by their measure, based on what they did. Verse 9. My eye will show no pity, nor will I spare. I will repay you according to your ways. While your abominations are in your midst, then you will know that I, the Lord, do the smiting. Behold the day. Behold its coming. Your doom has gone forth. The rod has budded. Arrogance has blossomed. Now what I want you to look at is, in this text, 10 through 13, we're talking about the social order of the nation going away, followed by the military. Watch this now, verse 10. The rod has budded, arrogance has blossomed, violence has grown into a rod of wickedness. None of them shall remain, none of the multitude, none of their wealth, nor anything eminent among them. The time has come, the day has arrived. Let not the buyer rejoice, nor the seller mourn. That's what I'm talking about when you think about the Great Depression at this time. If you had cash, you could get fabulously wealthy because you were buying then for 10 cents on the dollar. But he says when it completely falls apart, the buyer's not going to do well, the seller's not going to do well. Look at this in verse 13. For the vision regarding all their multitude will not be averted, nor will any of them maintain his life by his iniquity. Verse 14, military now falling apart. They have blown the trumpet and made everything ready. What happens with a city when the trumpets are blown? What does that mean?
To call to arms.
So yesterday, several of us were out playing golf, right? About 100 yards from Dow Chemical, just on the other side of the river, and all of a sudden a horn started going. I'm talking about a horn. Mangus knew what the horn meant.
Gas release.
Gas release. Not good. And we're thinking, are we downwind? That's what the trumpets were for in this day and time. Except, in this case, there's nobody to answer the trumpets. In verse 14, no one is going to battle. For my wrath is against all the multitude. The sword is outside, and the plague and the famines are within. He who is in the field will die by the sword. Famine and plague will also consume their cities. Even when the survivors escape, they will be on the mountains like doves in the valley, all of their mourning, each over what? So the one thing that God could never get them to do, and the prophets couldn't do it, is getting them to recognize and acknowledge their own abominations, their own sins. The New Testament tells us that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess Jesus Christ. Now look a little further as we finish this up. Verse 17, all hands will hang limp, all knees will become like water, and they will gird themselves with sackcloth and shudder. Shuddering will overwhelm them, and shame will be on all their faces. Why wasn't it on their faces before? Because they had been in it so long, they couldn't see the abomination. They could not see their own iniquity. Now take a look in verse 19, the economy. Then they will fling their silver into the streets, and their gold shall become an abhorrent thing, and their silver and their gold shall not be able to deliver them in the day of wrath. Well, it always worked before. Why is it not working now? Too late. The whole thing is falling apart. Verse 19, latter part, they cannot satisfy their appetite, nor can they fill their stomachs, for their iniquities have become an occasion of stumbling. And they transform the beauty of his ornaments into pride and made them the image of their abominations. That were the things in the temple that were the ornaments to Jehovah God. And they're detestable things with it, therefore I will make it an abhorrent thing to them. And I shall give into the hands of the foreigners as plunder, give them into the hands of the foreigners as plunder, and the wicked of the earth as spoil, and they will profane it. I shall turn my face from them, and they will profane my secret place. Then robbers will enter and profane it. And then the political. Verse 23. Make a chain, for the land is full of bloody crimes, and the city is full of violence. Therefore I shall bring the worst of the nation, and they will possess their houses. All of the high and mighty, all of the judges, the worst people in the world are going to live in their houses. I shall also make the pride of the strong ones cease, and their holy places will be profaned. When anguish comes, they will seek peace, but there will be none. Disaster will come upon disaster, and rumor will be added to rumor. That is, you don't know what to believe and what not to believe. They will seek a vision from the prophet. And what's God going to tell them? Days of the prophets are over, friend. You have the time to listen to them. But the law will be lost from the priest and the council from the elders. The king will mourn. The prince will be clothed with horror. The hands of the people of the land will tremble. According to their conduct, I shall deal with them. And by their judgment, I shall judge them. And they will know that I am the Lord. We'll stop there. Let me just ask. Yes.
Let's get this clear in mind.
Okay.
Now, this language here is to the people in Babylon.
Yes.
The people that it's actually happening to are all going to die, so it wouldn't do any good to tell them. Of course, Ezekiel is telling them, but he's not going to do any good. Now, this guy, this prophet, is telling this to the ones in Babylon so that they'll recognize what happened.
That's right.
And they're going to be equipped not to let it happen again.
And that's an excellent point, though, and I want you to think about this. That was Jeremiah's job. Now, there were other prophets. He was the major prophet. He was in Jerusalem. They're still working on, Ezekiel is, and Jeremiah, how big will the remnant be? How many people are going to come out of this unscathed?
With the knowledge of what happened.
That's right.
So that if the people that Ezekiel is prophesying to, if they listen to what he's saying and adhere to God's will, then they won't be among the people who die from the plague. They will be part of the remnant.
So as we read in chapter 6 and verse 12, those that are far away, who did not repent of their abomination, they're going to be destroyed by the plague. You weren't part of the battle. But throughout all of Jeremiah's time, how many times, and we did not spend much time in Jeremiah, I think when we finish Ezekiel, you're going to see some things. But here's what I want you to understand. All of this, God was saying, the nation will not make it. There was no remedy. I am taking charge of the land, and the land is going to have its Sabbaths. But the people, some of these human beings would be part of the 40,000 that comes back to help rebuild it. Now, do you think that God had handpicked 70 years in advance exactly who was going to make it and who wasn't? No. That's what this is all about. So Ezekiel is seeing it. And you're going to see, and here, this is where I want to go. We're a little bit late. Chapter 14, I want you to think about this. Here's in Babylon and in Jerusalem. If Noah and Daniel and Job lived in this town right here, they could not save the town. The three godliest people on earth. If their children lived in the house with them, they could not save their own children by their righteousness. And here's what I want to tell you. This is a little bit off the subject. When it comes to judgment, I want you to think about this. God is surgical. Always. When it came to the flood, Did God know to the person who was going to be saved?
Yes.
When it came to Sodom, Genesis 18, did he know exactly who was going to be saved? To the person.
Yes.
So, here's the preacher, or here's the prophet prophesying to the nation, but when judgment comes, God is surgical. You want to know why Job and Daniel and Noah couldn't save their own children? Because they either got a mark on their head or they don't. That's where we're headed with this. Any other comments or questions?
That's justice.
And let me say this. How many of you are sitting here right now with a little bit of a queasy feeling in your stomach because this doesn't really feel like justice to you?
It is justice.
Some of this means
what's wonderful because God is a righteous good. And he doesn't make mistakes. So that's what's so good about it.
So I say this to every one of you, young and old alike. If this kind of gives you a queasy feeling in your stomach, and you say, man, that doesn't sound like justice to me, it's probably because we have gone so far away in our thinking of what is justice and what is not. That's why we're studying this. You cannot be smarter than God. So when God says, this is justice. Thank you for listening. Lord willing, I want to look at chapter 14. It'll be next Wednesday night. We will look at chapter 14. And we'll look at some more detail on this chapter.
Glad to see each of you here this evening. I'm going to speak about the mic also. We'll have Brother Owen go ahead over for the invitation. As far as our announcements, we need to continue to remember Jewel in our prayers, as well as Van. And Rebecca and Mickey had to leave. Rebecca's not feeling well. So remember her, if you would, in your prayers. Jamie sent a message. She would like more phone calls. If you have opportunity, call her. As I understand, she's still in Kindred rehab.
And I have the number if somebody needs it.
It was in the bulletin on Sunday, yes. Jamie's number.
Betty has it in her hand.
Okay. So we have that number if you have an opportunity to call Jamie. She would like to talk with you, visit with you. Out of town, Shelby's out of town tonight. Vance and Jan are still gone, so remember them as they're away. Our shut-ins, remember Brother Pete, Sister Bronnie, as well as Brother Marvin. I'd like to see Mary back. Now she's still going through tests and hopeful that they'll find a resolution to their problem.
Holly's home with Brenda.
Brenda is sick, and Holly is home with her, is why they're not here this evening.
And Darcy's also out of town.
Say again?
Darcy
is out of town, as well as Shelby. Are they together? No, they're not.
They're not even close.
Oh, well. Okay, so remember them as they're away. Is there anything else we need to mention?
Nope.
There are a number of meetings in the area, and the Krennic girls, Mary and Carrie, are attending services in Clute tonight. Is that correct? They've been going. They wanted to hear the lesson tonight, so that's why they're not with us here this evening. Is there anything else we need to mention? If not, Brother Jason will be leading our singing. We'll be having books tonight, since I don't have anyone to operate the overhead. And Brother Ashley will have the opening prayer. Brother Owen will have the invitation. Brother Wayne will have the closing prayer. Brother Jason.
Dear beloved and merciful Father in heaven, it's again that we approach thy room, dear Father, giving thanks for this day and for this time that has been set aside that we might come together. We're so thankful, dear Father, for this opportunity that you've given us this day to live out this day and to be here tonight. Dear Father of heaven, we're mindful tonight of thy word, and we're mindful tonight of the strength of thy word, and we understand, dear Father, that as we look up in thy word and do those things that are written upon the pages of inspiration, it causes us to think more about this life and causes us to look more seriously about the hereafter and what we're doing while we're here. And we pray, dear Father, that as we live this life, that we might present ourselves in such a manner that those that are living around us might see the things in which we do and want to know more about thee. And dear Father of heaven, we thankful tonight for the group that meets here in Missouri, both individually and collectively. We pray, dear Father, that we might continue to look upon thy word and to continue to study and continue to do those things which causes us to be stronger in thee. And dear Father, we're thankful tonight for the sunshine which you've given us, the great things in which you have given us this day, and the food and everything else that we know comes from thee. And dear Father of heaven, we are mindful tonight of those that have been mentioned as being sick, those that are afflicted. We pray for Sister Janie. We pray for Brother Van. We pray for Sister Holly and Sister Brenda. We pray for all of those that may be sick tonight. We pray that their health would be restored to them, that they may once again be able to reassemble here with those that meet here at this place. And dear Father of heaven, we are mindful tonight of our responsibilities to thee. We're mindful, dear Father, that as we live, that we pray that we will live a life that is presentable to thee, and in the end, that you would be able to say, well done, thy good and faithful service. And dear Father of heaven, we pray for this service tonight and the things in which we say and the things in which we do, and we pray, dear Father, that they are in strict accordance with thy word. We pray that you might be with us through the further exercise of this night, through the further exercise of this class, the classes that we've had, and the services that we're having tonight. This is our prayer. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
If you've got the blue book handy, we'll sing song number 5, Farther Along.
Tempted and tried. Farther along we'll go.
26, trust and obey.
Share with you tonight some thoughts from the pen of the Apostle John. In his story of the life of Christ, and this one is working, I can hear it feeding back. He introduces to Jesus in this way. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And later, many years, he wrote 1 John, and he talks about Jesus in this way. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. He goes on to say, for the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. John wants you to know that what he's telling you is true. He lived it. He knew Jesus Christ. And he knew him very well. In the third verse, that which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that you may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. There's an end to what he's talking about. And that end is to have you understand the fellowship you enjoy, not with John, but with God Almighty and with Jesus Christ, His Son. What a glorious thought. What a wonderful idea that we, mere people, can have fellowship with God. He goes on to say, that which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that you may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. If it doesn't give you joy to understand that you have a relationship with God, you need to think about it. The pure, almighty creator of all things physical has allowed us to have a relationship, a fellowship with Him. I'm going to jump now to the second chapter, the first verse. My little children, John says, and he says the same thing to us. This wasn't written to us, but it was written for us. These things write unto you that ye sin not. Now that's the ideal situation. That's just the most ideal situation that exists. But he goes on to say, and if a man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. We have this picture in our mind, I hope we do, of Jesus Christ sitting at the right hand of God. And whenever we sin, he's saying to God, I've been there. I didn't do what they did. But I know what temptation feels like. I understand what they're going through and forgive them. He's our advocate with the Father. He is a propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The idea of propitiation is He paid the price. Jesus paid the price. And therefore, He is at the right hand of God, and therefore, He's in a position to talk to God about our sins. He's our advocate. Now in the third chapter, the first few verses. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. There's a great difference between those people who have fellowship with God, those people who have been bought by the blood of Jesus Christ, and the rest of the world. They don't recognize us. And how could they? Because they're of the world and we are not of the world. We have fellowship with God. We have Jesus sitting at his right hand, speaking up for us. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. And it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. We have this picture in our mind, the throne of God, Jesus Christ sitting at his right hand, our advocate. But we'll see it in reality one day. Because we are, as he said, beloved, we are in fellowship, and Jesus Christ is our spokesman. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself even as he is pure. You may be here tonight and have never purified yourself. The way you purify yourself doesn't mean that you earn purification. Jesus Christ paid the price. It means that you are willing to obey him. In that second chapter, John said, you sin not. But he goes on to say, we know we're sinners. But you can purify yourself if you never have by obeying the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we'll take you tonight and put you under the water and bring you forth to lead the new life in fellowship with God. If there's any other problem you have, we can take care of that then. We can pray about it with the assurance that Jesus is there speaking for us. Any way we can help you tonight, won't you come forward as we stand and sing?
When we walk with the Lord,
and obey. most gracious Heavenly Father, we humbly bow before you this evening, thanking you for the opportunity we've had tonight to come here once again to sing praises to you, to learn more from your word. We pray, Heavenly Father, the things that we've learned tonight, that we can be edified and be better Christians and be able to teach others as well. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, at this time for, I'm mindful of those who are ill. We ask that you be with them and comfort them, that may take their places once again with us. We ask that you be with our shut-ins as well. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, for those who are traveling. We pray for their safety, for their safety of the destination and a safe return. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, for not only the opportunity that we come here, but for the country that we live in, that we can do so without fear from anyone. And most thankful, dear and Father, for your Son, who Jesus, who came to this earth, who suffered, bled, and died for our sins. We ask you at this time to remain with us this hour, this place, and come as we depart this place, be back with us till we meet again. Forgive us of all our sins, in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.